So this is the first day of this four-day retreat here in Tampa at the Franciscan Center. Seeing life with clarity and intelligence, the path of Dharma. Sounds good. So let's get into it. Before we begin, though, I wanted to just share a few things that I think are important in relationship to listening to the Dharma. And here I am reading from Chapter 4 of The Heart of the Buddha's Teaching by Thich Nhat Hanh. He says, when we hear a Dharma talk or study a sutra, our only job is to remain open. Can everybody hear me? Our only job is to remain open. Usually when we hear or read something new, we just compare it to our own ideas. If it is the same, we accept it and say it is correct. If it is not, we say it is incorrect. In either case, we learn nothing. If we read or listen with an open mind and an open heart, the rain of the Dharma will penetrate the soil of our consciousness. And then he quotes an earlier poem of his that went, the gentle spring rain permeates the soil of my soul. A seed that has lain deeply in the earth for many years just smiles. Quite beautiful. The gentle spring rain permeates the soil of my soul. A seed that has lain deeply in the earth for many years just smiles. So this is very important. We are all here because all of our thinking, all of our analyzing, all of our reading has not brought us the freedom, the peace, the happiness that we seek. Coming to a spiritual path, coming to a retreat, is for all of us an admission of failure. Right? I cannot do it on my own. I cannot get out of the box. And of course, on our own, we can't get out of the box. Because the box is a box of our own creation. It is our box. And we have fashioned it with great perseverance, this lifetime, if not many lifetimes. So of course it is impossible for us, no matter how many good thoughts we think, to when it comes down to our life, to make it work. So really coming to a spiritual path involves a certain degree of surrendering. Of admitting that one cannot figure it out for oneself, or one cannot do it on one's own. So Thich Nhat Hanh is talking about, so therefore when we have that seeking mind, right, that it is an open mind. Right? It is a mind that does not impose its own views on what it is hearing. It is willing to take it in. It is. He uses the beautiful example of the gentle spring rain permeates the soil of my soul. He's not just a great Dharma teacher, he's a poet. Right? And we know that when it rains, and we know rain is essential, right, for seeds and plants to grow, that when it rains, it seeps into the earth. And when it seeps into the earth, it has the capacity of touching and bringing life to and nourishing that are seeds that lie dormant in the earth. Right. If the earth is hard pack, right, or if it is a rock, nothing will get in. So it is very important that we understand that we are here. Whatever you think, last night I said, why are you here? Think about why you're here. Set your intentions. But I was really setting you up, now that I think of it. Because the truth is, we really, at the deepest level, don't know why we're here. We're here really because we can't help not being here. We don't know why we're here, at the deepest level. The truth is, we are here because there are seeds within us that are seeking nourishment. Right. Just the way we can say, in the winter, under the earth, there are all sorts of dormant seeds. Right. But for the seed to fulfill itself, right, it looks forward to the rain, to the warmth, to the spring rains and the warmth of spring, so it can grow. The gentle spring rain permeates the soil of my soul. A seed that has lain deeply in the earth for many years just smiles. That is often why we enjoy Dharma talks. We enjoy listening to Dharma talks. It's something it somehow we smile, because we don't even know it, because those seeds within us are being nourished. A seed that has lain deeply in the earth for many years just smiles. How wonderful. He then goes on to say, allow the rain of the Dharma to come in and penetrate the seeds that are buried deep in your consciousness. A teacher cannot give you the truth. The truth already is in you. You need only to open yourself, body, mind, and heart, so that his or her teachings will penetrate your own seeds of understanding and enlightenment. If you let the words enter you, the soil and the seeds will do the rest of the work. So that's quite beautiful. There certainly is a time for critical thinking. And actually, this retreat is on developing right view and seeing clearly. But again, if there is no openness, there is no learning. Right? If the earth is covered, the soils will never receive, even though it's raining and raining, and even though the sun is shining. Right? If a poor seed has ended up under a rock, there's a good chance it will not grow. And then, in a more traditional formulation, and you've probably heard me talk about it before, and this also may speak to us in terms of listening to a Dharma talk, being a Dharma student. It says, and I'm reading here from Words of My Perfect Teacher by the great Tibetan master Patro Rinpoche. He says, not to listen is to be like a pot turned upside down. Not to be able to retain what you hear is to be like a pot with a hole in it. To mix negative emotions with what you hear is to be like a pot with poison in it. So if you think about the mind, your mind is a pot. Ideally, the pot is upright. It has no holes. It is clean. And when the pure substance, the ambrosia, is poured in, it has a lovely bowl, clean bowl, solid bowl to hold it. So when we drink, we get the full nourishment, right? Again, if our mind is up, if the pot is upside down, like many of our minds, no matter how much wonderful ambrosia is poured, it will all just spill on the ground. So if we wonder why I have a pot and I've been pouring ambrosia or trying to pour ambrosia in it all these years and nothing seems to have gotten in, it could be because our pot is upside down. We don't really let it in. It's all on the surface, right? So that's one kind of pot. Please reflect. If you have been pouring, exposing yourself to the lots of pouring in of ambrosia that supposedly has wonderful powers to make you happy and transform you, and you are still not, then maybe it's because your pot is upside down. Now, then there is another kind of pot. This is a familiar pot. This is a pot that has holes in it. Looks like a good pot. The ambrosia is poured in. It seems to be going right in the pot. We're feeling good. I'm no longer the upside down pot. But somehow, when I pick it up to drink, there's nothing there. Now that again, that's like a lot, that's the leaky pot. We do not hold on to. We think receiving it once is enough. We pour it in, we say, good, I'm doing great. I just got a pot full of ambrosia. I just got a pot full of Dharma, of truth. But over time, because we do not use it, because we do not constantly drink from it, it just leaks out. And then we wonder why when we get into life, right? Many people say, what's wrong with me, right? I study, I come to Sangha, I go to retreats, right? And yet in my daily life, right? Where is it? Where's all these wonderful teachings? I go on retreat, I come to Sangha in my home, I feel peaceful. But why is it as soon as I enter life, same old, right? All my old stuff comes up. Well, it's because our pot has leaked. We have a leaky pot. So when you say, oh, I need to have a drink, quick drink of Dharma to get me through this, there's nothing there. We do not recall, we do not remember, the Dharma has leaked away. And then the final one is this dirty pot, okay? So now we have the pot is upright, there are no holes, right? The pure ambrosia is poured in. But unfortunately, our bowl has not been cleaned. Cleaned of what? Cleaned of all our wrong views, our wrong perception, our egocentricity, our arrogance, our doubt, our lack of confidence. I mean, you know, it's so these are all the contaminants, right? Even though we are drinking the ambrosia, it's not working because it's mixed with our own poison. Strong metaphor. An Indian, a great Indian yogi, a Buddhist yogi from India who came to Tibet and was quite well known, shows things need to be updated. He says, listen to the teachings like a deer listening to music. How many of us are aware of what a deer, what it's like when a deer listens to music? But you would imagine he's saying what? A deer, I guess, would be quite entranced, right? Never having heard music, it hears music. The deer is just spellbound. Listen to the teachings like a deer listening to music. Contemplate them like a northern nomad shearing sheep. I would imagine that a northern nomad shearing sheep is very concentrated on what they're doing. Very focused, wholly involved, shearing sheep. Meditate on them like a dumb person savoring food. Interesting. A dumb person here, it doesn't mean a stupid person. I think they're meaning a dumb person is someone who can't speak, you know, like deaf and dumb. So it's sort of acknowledging that that the fruits really can't be put in words. In the same way someone who can't speak can be having wonderful tastes, and yet there are no words for it. And yet, of course, you know, both the dumb person who doesn't have the power of speech and a person who has the power of speech are both having the same experience, right? And yet the person who can't speak, it's all very personal. We don't need to run around and tell everybody our experiences, do we? Practice them like a hungry yak eating grass. How would a hungry yak eat grass? Non-stop. Right? Practice like a hungry yak eating grass. Reach their result like the sun coming out from behind the clouds. Right? On a cloudy day when the sun comes out, how do we feel? Happy. Instantly happy. And in that moment, everything is lit up. Right? We know when that quality of sunlight is added. Flowers and trees and grasses and people all have a brilliance to them, right? Because of the sunlight. Reach the result like the sun coming out from behind the clouds. So, this is how we are to listen to the teachings. Please put the words of Thich Nhat Hanh, a modern-day teacher, Pacho Rinpoche, a traditional teacher, please put them into practice and understand very clearly if you are not getting the results that you have expected. It could be because of the way you are listening to the teachings, the kind of mind that you bring to the teachings, the type of pot you are. So, this retreat is called Seeing Life with Clarity and Intelligence, The Path of Dharma. And now reading from the introduction that we sent out, that everybody here received. It was written, "The practices of mindfulness and meditation are not enough to support our healing and transformation. To truly reduce our suffering and to live a life of freedom and ease, we must view this ever-changing life with insight and wisdom." So this may be new for people, some people, right? These days in our culture, mindfulness is kind of often these days marketed as a standalone. Right? And many people believe that through the practice of mindfulness, healing and transformation is possible for them. And yet, in traditional teaching of the Buddha, that is not the case. While mindfulness certainly brings many benefits to those who are unmindful, in many ways, and I don't need to go into them. We actually, the last retreat and our last intensive all dealt with mindfulness and mindful living, and many of you are here because you've come in through the gateway of mindfulness and mindful living. So while mindfulness can certainly enrich life, while mindfulness and concentration can certainly quiet the mind and calm the mind and create a more peaceful mind and create greater openness and buoyancy in how one feels, it does not have the power by itself to free us from the suffering that we impose on ourselves. And in the Buddha's teaching, the Eightfold Path, we know that mindfulness is just one of eight spokes. The Buddha set forth a holistic path, of which mindfulness and even mindfulness and meditation are just parts. But he was very clear that it is only the spoke of wisdom and insight that has the possibility of freeing us from our suffering. Now, why is that? It is because we suffer because of our ignorance. Ignorance is the opposite of wisdom, right? Wisdom is the wisdom of really knowing things as they are, knowing the truth about reality, a truth about life, the truth about who and what I am and what human beings are and why people suffer and, you know, and what creates happiness and well-being, right? When you know that, we would say what? It's a wise human being. That person has wisdom. They know things as they really are and live accordingly. Ignorance is the lack of wisdom. When people do not know the nature of reality, when they do not know the nature of self, when they do not know what is the, you know, what suffering is or what causes suffering or how to end suffering, if they don't know the possibility of happiness and well-being and what are the causes and create that, right? If somebody is ignorant of all that, then they will continually, no matter what they do, no matter how good their intentions are, will continue to create suffering for themselves and others. They can't help it. They're ignorant. And when we create suffering for ourselves and for others, it is because of our ignorance. It is not because we're bad people. Right? It is not because we don't mean well. But we are not, at this point, living from wisdom, from understanding. Right? This is fundamental. In Buddhism, the basis of living an enlightened life is wisdom. In Buddhism, the basis of leading a life of suffering and dissatisfaction is ignorance. Is that clear? It's not because of your karma. It's not because of any of that. kind of karma you've developed is because of is because of your wisdom or your ignorance. My wisdom or ignorance, our wisdom and ignorance. Is that clear? It's important that we understand that. So that is why it is said here that mindfulness and meditation are not enough to support our healing and transformation, to truly reduce our suffering, and to live a life of freedom and ease. We must view this ever-changing life with insight and wisdom. And then the second paragraph said, the Buddha's fundamental teachings about right view, and you remember in the Eightfold Path, they're all, you know, the eight rights. The Buddha's fundamental teachings about right view offers us an intelligent, wise, and practical template to understand life, why it unfolds the way it does, and how to relate to it in a skillful and compassionate way. Without right view, we will be prone to misperceiving and misinterpreting life, and therefore be constantly stirring the waters of afflictive mind states and emotions. With right view, we have the opportunity to live a life of calmness, openness, and love. Things that probably everybody here would say, I'll take a big order of that. Without right view, we are always struggling. We are always falling short of the mark. Again, it is not because we are failures. It is because we have not understood a right view deeply, and we do not live from it. In this retreat, I will be talking about and presenting, and in the guided meditations, many teachings that you have heard before. Okay? Same old, same old. The only difference is, my hope is that in this retreat, we will get it. And so I understand that for pretty much everybody here, the reason you don't get it, the reason we haven't gotten it, is not because of we don't intellectually understand. There will be hardly a teaching that I will bring. Maybe sometimes people struggle with the teachings of non-self or emptiness, but most of the teachings presented are just so obvious. Right? That even an elementary school kid could probably say, I understand that. So the issues are not our intellectual understanding. It's something deeper and more entrenched. So I want to have this retreat be open to dialogue, because it's going back to the time of the Buddha, it is in dialogue. I mean, if you read the Buddha sutras, you will see. Most of the sutras are not just sermons by the Buddha. Most of them involve our talks he gave in response to questions, and they're dialogues. There's back and forth. So taking that as an example, please, as this unfolds, I want to hear from you. If something doesn't make sense, if you object, if you think you can't practice, or something gets in the way, or there are obstacles, or, you know, it's we need to bring them out, and we need to look at them, and I will do my best to help you. So when we talk about view, when we talk here about right view, we're talking about, what are we talking about? You know, like this is a lovely view, right? A view is kind of a big picture kind of look, right? You know, it's not just the tree and the leaf and a plant. It's a view. It's kind of how you take in the whole thing, right? That's my view. Another way is, while at the deepest level, the Buddhist teachings can all be understood intuitively and directly, non-verbally, yet when the Buddha's teaching, the basic Buddhist outlook is put into words, we could call that the view. Right? When the Buddhas, when the masters put their realization into words, they are sharing with us their view, the way they see things, right? The way they view things. From this larger view comes thoughts, right? That's kind of a step down. But it is the view, the bigger view, that is conditioning the thoughts, the perceptions, the ideas. Is that clear? So we're looking big picture, and we're looking the way a Buddha, an enlightened one, views this life, views reality. And that is wonderful for people like us, because we are lazy, and we are distracted. Right? And so therefore, out of their compassion, the masters and the Buddhas take their realization and they put them into words. They share with us their view. And so now all we need to do for starters is understand their view and adopt it and live by it. You see how easy that is? No, I mean, I'm serious. You see how easy that is? Oh, I don't have to, I don't have to renounce the world and wander about northern India, with nothing for 6 years, right? I don't have to give up everything. I don't have to give up my home, my family, my loved ones, as the Buddha did. I don't have to give up all the things in life that I've always loved and give me happiness, like the Buddha did, right? I don't have to endure all kinds of difficulties, all kinds of hardships, right? None of us have to do that, do we? We have it easy. Somebody has done it for us. Is that clear? Somebody has done it for us, and for 2,600 years, other people have replicated the possibility that if you live by this view, right, you can become an enlightened one. Is there anybody who disagrees with that or doesn't get it? I mean, please don't be shy or don't be scared. I'm serious. I'm saying it's that easy. Somebody's already done the experiment. Right? Somebody's already done the hard work. All we need to do is adopt that view and live by it. I mean, does that sound easy or not? Charlie.
So, looking at my own life, it's a simple part to I can adopt it, I can understand it intellectually.
We're not talking about understanding intellectually. We know you can understand it intellectually, Charlie. You've been understanding this intellectually for how many years?
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's not about understanding it intellectually. Yeah, it's like you... It's like you're willing to live by it, as opposed to your own view. Where has your own view gotten you? I mean, it's as simple as that. Right? It's acknowledging I have a limited view. I don't see clearly. It doesn't get me out of the box that I've created. you know. But there is somebody out there who's got the big view, who's out of the box. So all I have to do is what? Yeah, we just adopt it for starters. Replace my view, my limited view, my skewed view, which is traditionally labeled as ignorance, narrow, a narrow view, a view that does not lead to happiness and peace and well-being. I need to let go of that view and adopt a view that does. Right? I don't need to go to India. I don't need to change my clothes. I don't need to chuck my wife. I don't need to give up my new home in Sun City. Right? You know? I just got to change my view. I mean, that should make you happy. Is there anything that's not clear? No. Anybody else wondering about view? This morning, for example, the five remembrances. Steve, can you? Where is that piece of paper? Thank you. Thank you. So one of the views, one of the ways that life is seen by the Buddha and by all the teachers and masters for 2,600 years is impermanence. Anybody ever heard impermanence before? Everybody's heard the word impermanence. Okay. Is there anybody who disagrees that things are impermanent? Is there anybody who says, no, things are permanent? I look exactly the same. I came out of my mother's womb this way. And I haven't changed a bit. And neither is my mother, by the way. And her mother. We're all living in the same house together. We look exactly the same. We laugh. Why do you laugh, Charner? Yeah, it's ridiculous because Charner knows what? Everything changes. And yet, right? So there are many facets, but impermanence, let's begin with impermanence. So here's a quote from a Buddhist teaching. Again, you all know this. Whatever is born is impermanent and is bound to die. Whatever is stored up is impermanent and is bound to run out. Whatever comes together is impermanent and is bound to come apart. Whatever is built is impermanent and is bound to collapse. Whatever rises up is impermanent and is bound to fall down. So also friendship and enmity, fortune and sorrow, good and evil, all the thoughts that run through your mind, everything is always changing. Is there anybody here who would take issue with that? Any part of that? Was there anybody here who would say that's not the truth? The truth would, if you said this was untrue, you would believe whatever is born is permanent and will never die. See, it's interesting when you turn it around. Whatever is stored up is permanent and will never run out. Whatever comes together is permanent and will never come apart. Whatever is built is permanent and will never collapse. Whatever rises up is permanent and will never fall down. Friendship, enmity, fortune, sorrow, good, evil, all the thoughts that run through my mind, nothing ever changes. Now that's the verse of people who have wrong view. Right? Is that clear? The way the verse originally was read is the verse of right view. Right? Seeing the way things really are. Having a correct view of reality. Now, how many people put themselves on the side of the impermanent verse? How many people put themselves on the side of the permanent verse? Nobody's willing to admit it.
I put my sides on both.
Ooh, why is that?
Because now I understand that this body is impermanent, mm-hmm. and everything in day-to-day life is impermanent. Everything I experience here is impermanent. I also have an abiding belief, faith, that the Buddha mind is something permanent, and that when I'm in the Buddha mind and when I'm experiencing the Buddha mind, that is permanent. And even though that's not here, it is here. It's a paradox. So I'm on the side of both of them.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, Susan, according to Buddha's teaching, there is no such thing as the Buddha mind, and nothing is permanent.
There's no such concept as the Buddha mind.
There's no such thing as the Buddha mind.
Well, a thing, a concept, but there is a place that I go, and it seems permanent to me.
Really? Yeah. It's always the same.
It's not unchanging, but it's always there. There are no words for it.
Good. So be like a dumb person eating savory food. So let me get this straight. I just except for Susan, but it sounds as if pretty much everybody agrees with the verse. Whatever is born is impermanent, is bound to die. Whatever is stored up is impermanent, bound to run out. Whatever comes together is impermanent, bound to come apart. Whatever is built is impermanent, bound to collapse. Whatever rises up is impermanent, bound to fall down. Friendship, enmity, fortune, sorrow, good and evil, all the thoughts that run through my mind, everything is changing. Most people would say that's true. Okay, and nobody here would even say that everything is permanent, nothing dies, nothing runs out, nothing ever comes apart, nothing collapses, nothing ever falls down, and everything always stays the same, including the thoughts of my mind. Am I correct? Yes, Ruth.
What about conditioning?
What about conditioning?
Conditioning is pretty permanent unless we learn or become willing to change it.
Then it's not permanent. There's no...
It can be changed, so therefore it's not permanent. Mm-hmm. Many people, and you've often said this, unless we practice, conditioning is permanent. People don't change.
Again, we will go into the teaching of karma and cause and effect, conditioning. But basically, there is no permanent thing called conditioning. All there is causes and conditions and many variables. Because of that, right, they are impermanent, all causes and conditions, all conditions are impermanent and are subject to change. That's what the teaching and practice is about. If you see them as permanent, and many people see their conditioning as permanent, they will always be bound by them. Right? So that's why, again, how we view things is so key here, right? I mean, if I think all my childhood conditioning, everything is permanent, they're real things, they're solid, I can never change, this is me, that's the way we'll be. But if you believe, you know, all the experiences of life, all of them impermanent, there is no self to ever that they were ever, I mean, they were nothing more than experiences. There was no central thing called a self that they ever really happened to. That's all ignorance. And therefore, all they are is conditioning. And like any kind of conditioning, I mean, even the, you know, what condition? You know, such as causes and conditions have created that beautiful Buddha, right? But if we put a match to him, if we change the conditions, that beautiful Buddha would become ash. If we chopped off his hands and his head, he would be the handless, headless Buddha. I mean, he appears as a, he appears like that, but that's only because of causes and conditions, right? A wood carver, the wood, you know. But that's all it is. If you look at that as a permanent thing, you would not know that that has the possibility already to be headless, to be armless, and to be ash. That's all there. Just got to change the variables, change the conditions. It all depends on your view. So, yes, Maria.
I understand the right view, the realistic view, and agree on it totally with a theoretical, from a theoretical level.
Mm-hmm.
However, that impermanence, if I think now, oh, I could run out of my good fortune, that scares me so much.
Mm-hmm.
Where the fear comes in, where I cannot adopt.
Good. I'm glad you admitted it. And you know what? Everybody in here is with you, but we'll get to that. Yeah, the first one to tell the truth. Because Maria just told the truth that we all share. That intellectually, right, she understands impermanence. But when it comes to the actual things of her life, it's a whole different ball game. And that is why the truth is, and Maria is just the first brave person to say it, is that even though intellectually we still don't, that still we still have not adopted impermanence as our view, right? Because if you did adopt it to your view, it's not that you would yearn to lose everything or want to lose everything, but you would understand that that certainly is a possibility, isn't it? Right? And so therefore, it would not scare you. You wouldn't even think about it. But if it happened, you would deal with it. Right? Because you believe truly that everything's impermanent. See, I mean, again, this is why it's always fascinating to me, the five remembrances. I mean, how many people here have recited the five remembrances more than 10 times in their life? More than 50 times in their life, more than 100 times in their life. I mean, right? And yet, we are such hypocrites. We are such phonies. We are such pretenders because, right? Because we get a little sick and we go, what? Why is this happening to me? Right. Or somebody we care about it gets sick. We go, oh, this shouldn't be happening to them. And especially if it gets more significant kind of disease, then we're really upset. Right? You know, I mean we look in the mirror and we see that older that aging person and we go, what? That can't be me. I'm not supposed to look like that. Right? And yet we say that we believe in impermanence. We repeat, I am of the nature to grow old. Well, what do you think that means? You know, I mean, like it's like some kind of, you know, in some kind of abstract intellectual realm, we know everything. You know, I am of the nature to grow old. This body, that means this body, This body is of the it is its nature. It can't help growing old. It's normal to grow old. Aging is normal. Everything ages. You know, we apply aging, you know, that's nice, you see, because we don't want to use words like what? Decay. Deterioration. You know, that's the truth. Everything else, well, that's decaying. Right? That's wilting. I'm aging. You see what I'm saying? We can't even speak the truth to ourselves. The truth is what? We are decaying. Everything decays. Everything that comes into being goes through a period of growth and development, and then it decays, deteriorates, and eventually it will what? Die. It will end its physical incarnation in the form that it grew in. That is the nature of everything. From a thought to an amoeba to a human being to an earth to a universe. That is the nature of reality. And we want to view, we want to see it clearly. So why? So we don't suffer. Yeah. Steve, did you have something?
I was going to say that I'm aware of that on a daily basis. You're like me. Every time I take my glasses off. Yeah, my glasses off, all of a sudden I can't see. I'm not worried. It wasn't that way when I was 15.
And that is, and the reason your eyes are blurry is because why? Yeah. Deteriorating. Decaying. You're rotting right before us. There's a great saying, I think, in Miller Repper or something, where he goes, you know. It's like, you know, you're a big shot, right? Everybody loves to have you around. Everybody depends on you and your family. You're a big tribal chief or something. You're a day after you're dead, all they're doing is thinking about how they can get rid of your body, you know? Before this thing, you know, begins to stink or rot, or let's, you know, who wants to keep them around? I mean, it's like, you know, I mean, it's a great reminder, right? If you want to see the corpse, look at, you know, this body is the corpse. This has the nature to be a corpse. Yes, Susan. Again, right view, Susan. Right view. It's all the same.
Right.
When we know that everything's impermanent, and that impermanence is the and we'll talk about probably karma in the next day or two. That karma, cause and effect, you know, is kind of the operating principle of this world of impermanence, right? You will understand that what is going on in the world is because of causes and conditions, right? Causes create effects. Right? So we might, if you are somebody who believes that change in weather patterns and things like that may have something to do with human beings, we know there are those who don't. But if you're one of those who do, who sees a causal relationship, then you understand why things are unfolding the way they are. You may have a foresight to understand one of the things about maturity, right? It's like, maturity of for all of us, is, in the maturity of a child, is their ability to see cause and effect, to see how this will lead to that, right? I mean, one of the reasons adolescents or teenagers are so scary is because they deny it. They don't see cause and effect, so therefore they live in a world where they're endlessly making causes without awareness that they will have effects, right? In a certain way, we could say the human race is very much like that. We just go around doing whatever we want and not willing to look at the effects, short-term and medium and long-term. We want to help view those two things. We'll be unfolding over these next days. View helps us understand clearly the nature of reality, why things are the way they are, right? And why things will be the way they will be. But the impermanence also gives us the understanding that if causes change, that can modify effects. So that's why Buddhism is a very positive, very hopeful. Coming back to what Ruth said, it's the same thing. It's like, I had a terrible childhood, nobody loved me, I grew up, thinking this and that, and then this happened and that happened. There are lots of causes and conditions which has, brought somebody to the position where they go, well, this is who I am, I'm a terrible person and only terrible things happen to me. People end up that place. But if they practice Buddhism, they know that's not true at all. You just happen to be, it's not quite true, but in the wrong place at the wrong time, and things happened. But it was never about you, and, understanding that, you have the possibility right now of creating a whole nother path for yourself. Right? Because everything is impermanent. And it's the same way for this earth and the people on it, I mean, we could make significant changes today if human beings would grow up, right? But human beings are immature. They live for the present in the worst sense of it, right? Their minds ensnared with ignorance, with greed, with self-centeredness, only thinking of themselves. How could they not mess things up? So when you have understanding and right view, you understand that. I mean, that is why Dharma, not Dharma, like only Buddha Dharma, but understanding and wisdom is so essential. If we really want to change the course, the course of our own life, or our family's life, the course of the world. Yes, Alex.
I've heard you say on several occasions that when you were welcoming people to the Sangha at our center, Buddhism does not come into conflict with religion. You can be of a different religion and still be welcomed and practice Buddhism.
Mm-hmm.
And you talk about there being nothing permanent. But for billions of people, their faith is permanent. They believe that there's a God, believe that they have faith in God, and that will be impermanent. And we're in this...
And that is permanent.
That in their minds.
It's permanent. Right.
And that's a deep conviction.
Mm-hmm.
And we're in this, facility, and we had the sister talk about how... we are welcomed, and that this is all, part of the vision of St. Francis of Assisi, and he believed that he was serving God, and this is what was permanent. So how do you then juxtapose this view that nothing is permanent with the idea that billions of people
some of which want to understand Buddhism, believe that there is something permanent in this cosmos of faith in God.
That's true. I mean, what? I mean, I think you're making a question whether really. What's the question? I mean, that is, you just stated the case. Yeah, there are many people who believe that things are permanent, and if they're not some ordinary things and some kind of super mundane things, that's the truth. People believe that. And, you know, some people believe it very fixedly, and some people are much more open about their beliefs. They're willing to have their beliefs, but also to... willing to listen to other people's beliefs. Right? I mean, Buddhism, you know, is different in how it views views. Views are based on reality. Views are not, you know, the right view is based on reality, as we're talking about. It's not based on a belief or faith. It's based on reality. I mean, the Buddha called right view the correct way to understand reality, means what's happening. So it is reality based. It's scientific in that sense. We know there are many people who you know, ideas and beliefs do not have to be reality based. They are faith based, and that's the truth. That's the world we live in, right? So therefore, you know, we have to be open to hearing other people's beliefs, hoping they may want to hear our belief. And again, whether I believe in a super mundane God, who, right, or if I don't believe in that, we both might agree that the world's a mess, and that better stewardship of the earth and its resources, more caring for the people on it, you know, we might all agree on that. And that's, at the end of the day, that's what's important, right? I mean, just because I'm a Buddhist doesn't make me anybody special, right? I can still be a jerk. So at the end of the day, you know, whatever one belief system one ascribes to, at the end of the day, it's, you know, the kind of person you are, and that's I think that's what we should care about. So I am of the nature to grow old. Again, if we have really meditated on that and have become convinced of it, we will never again be in any way disturbed by aging within ourselves or anybody else. Is that true? I mean, is that how you would know that no longer have I just have an intellectual understanding, but I understand, you know, I am of the nature to grow old. There's no way to escape growing old. That's just the way it is. There's no more resistance. There's no more frustration. There's no more disappointment. There's no more... What? You don't buy that?
No, I don't. I mean, if I were a fully enlightened Buddha, perhaps. But otherwise, a human being loves somebody, and even if they have a full understanding that the person that they love is in the process of decaying and dying, when that person dies...
Oh, I haven't gotten to death yet. I'm just an aging.
Okay, aging. Can we do disease?
No, we're working up.
Okay.
We're working up, okay? Can you accept that everybody ages?
Yes.
Okay. So again, if you accept that everybody ages, again, and you really have, and with what we can do this retreat, you will never again, be bothered, upset, frustrated when you look at yourself or anybody else, because you will know what I'm seeing is normal. Right? Look at this, radiant and fresh, right? But over these next days, it will what? It will age.
not die yet.
It's age. Those of us who don't like to prettify it say it's rotting. But let's just be nice here and say this flower is aging. It'll move into its seniorhood. Right? It is moving into its golden years here. Is that clear? And it will eventually, what, Susan?
Well, I didn't know if I was allowed to say it, but die.
Well, I'm just kind of anticipating. Right. And you know, Susan, do you accept that? Do you accept, because if you don't, you will be, what? As you watch every day that flower lose its vibrancy, lose its color, lose its form, begin to lose its tone, slowly wilt, eventually it just decays, falls off the leaves, the blossom, brown, right? I mean, will you be very sad? Will you be brokenhearted?
I can only answer by saying, I just went through the death of a neighbor.
And good.
He was in the hospital, mm-hmm. deteriorating and decaying. I was with him and his wife mm-hmm. throughout the process of the moment mm-hmm. when it happened. I told myself daily mm-hmm. that he was of a nature to die.
Mm-hmm.
We spoke openly mm-hmm. about it. We spoke openly about death. I went through the process mm-hmm. with him. And yet, when he died, mm-hmm. I cried.
No, that's okay.
But there, so,
that's called sadness. That's not a big deal.
So, okay, but there is some sorrow. I guess I'm not a fully enlightened Buddha because I wasn't able to say, he's of a nature to die, and when it happened, say, okay, happen now.
No. We're human beings. In the same way, things make us happy. You know, I mean, if you're at the birth of one of your nieces or nephews, you're not going to go, no. All right. You know, welcome. Right? You are hopefully you're going to be happy. And yet you know, right, that 6 months from now that little infant will not look the same. And 6 years from now will not look the same. And you don't know what's going to happen to it, and it will die one day. Right? And it may grow up to be a wondrous being, and it may grow up to be a serial killer. You don't know that, do you? No. Because things are impermanent. And yet, at birth, you can be happy. And at death, you can be sad. But if that happiness or sadness is not infused or perfumed with right views, it can become a source of suffering. Okay? So this is not about becoming impervious to feeling. This is not about, some sort of callous indifference to life. It's not like that. But it means that we are seeing everything clearly and at the same time fully participating in human. I am of the nature to grow old. There is no way to escape growing old. By the end of this retreat, it is my hope that everybody in here will no longer be bothered by their own aging or anybody else's. They will understand. Flowers, seasons, right? It was cold this morning, wasn't it? Look at us in Florida wearing sweaters. Well, it's bizarre. And yet we know what? It's a season. It'll pass. Something else will happen. Something will come. Today is blue and sunny. Tomorrow may be cloudy, right? We understand that. Everything changes. Everything. We sit in meditation. Thoughts come and go. Feelings come and go. Sensations come and go. It is endless. Why? Because that is the nature. That is the nature of thought. What is the nature of thought? Impermanence. When you know that, they no longer bother you. Charna, why'd you give me that funny look? You know what we call that? Right view. It's not just Fred's nice way of looking at things. I'm not making this up. This is what has been transmitted for thousands of years, this teaching. Is that clear? Right view. Gunter.
Well, I have my philosophical moment, right? I'm thinking what you teach here, what Buddha's teaching us, is the absolute fundamental scientific truth, right? Because even every atom, sooner or later, will decay to lower energy states.
Right.
But then I'm wondering, why are 99.999% of people, and I'm one of those, are so resistant against the scientific truth? Is there some kind of self-preservation in there? I mean, what does this accomplish?
Well, this is a big one. Maybe we can get into this tomorrow, okay? No, but I'm serious. This is important because, you're talking about the key piece. But let me today just lay it out, and then we'll talk about, again. Remember the words of the Buddha that I'm using about right view, right? He's really, it's science. I mean, he said, this is the correct view of reality. And you're saying, based on modern science investigation of matter and reality, physical reality, mental reality, it's truth, right? It's truth. So, we can certainly say that the Buddha and all the great meditators and masters were people who did a scientific experiment. They experimented with truth. They looked deeply into, they investigated. Buddhist meditation, insight meditation is called investigation. Right? Investigation. Right? It's not afraid. It's not a belief system. It's not a dogma. It's not catechism. It says, investigate it. Investigate the nature of reality. What do you see? Is this reality, physical and mental, internal and external, for beginners, is it permanent or impermanent? Does it stay the same or does it change? It's like fundamental. Right? This is our reality. Gunter raises the issue, why is it so obvious, that most people don't see it? Yeah, well, that's a good question. We'll get into that, but
I don't think when I say not see it, resisted.
Resisted, yeah.
Stronger,
right. But that resisted almost implies that they even know about seeing it. I mean, it's that, I think the truth is probably more, most people just never ask the question, right? Yes, Spence.
I was earlier getting a glimpse in what I was thinking, but it has to do with what he was thinking with also.
Mm-hmm.
There's traditional truth that we know, and you're talking about just the normal truth that we should accept. But I think what she was getting at was possibly what Pippin refers to as the ultimate truth. There's something beyond the traditional truth that we have. It's like in the chants when they talk about emptiness is form, form is emptiness, know this, know that. You know. You could also almost say no permanence, no impermanence. There's something beyond that. That's what I was talking about.
Again, we are, the question is, in Buddhism, isn't there something that is beyond these opposites, permanence and impermanence? Actually, in Buddhism, as taught by the Buddha at the deepest level, it is said a right view is no view. But that is the deepest truth. Actually, in the teachings of right view, there are two levels. There's the relative and the absolute, right? At the relative level, it is what we're talking about, which is understanding the nature of this life, this relative life, what are its laws, and so how we can operate in it in the most skillful, beneficial way. That is important. That is probably most important. At the same time, for those who want to go deeper, there is what's called the viewless view. And when you put those two together, you have enlightenment. But one can have right view and get significant mileage out of it. Okay, I am of the nature to have ill health. That's called sick. Disease. Is there anybody here who would disagree that it is not the nature of human bodies, of bodies, to get ill, to have disease? Is there anybody who would disagree with that? We have several physicians in the room. They make their living treating illness and disease. Right? Is there anybody who would disagree with it? That it's normal. That no matter how many supplements one takes, no matter how many times one washes one's hands with antibacterial soap, no matter how careful one is, right, even if one exercises, eats a vegan diet, takes all the proper supplements, that still one's body can get ill in one form or another. Is there anybody who disagrees with that? That means everybody agrees with it, which means we will never again, ever deny the reality and the normality of illness, disease, infirmity, disability. All these things are normal. They will happen to us. They are normal. Nothing to despair about, nothing to be angry about. People treat their bodies as if they're creations of the mind, right? We have this mind. It loves to have ideas and expectations and make plans, right? The mind is boundless. It can imagine anything. Right? And then we get disappointed that our body, can you believe it, gets sick. So we can't fulfill the plans that the mind made. I made all these plans, either for tonight or for my life. And can you believe, you know, somehow the body seems to have its own life or something. I can't believe it. It's not in sync with me. Right? It's kind of schizophrenic, isn't it? Kind of. Bodies, when we talk about sickness, old age, and death, we are talking about what? See, this is very dramatic for people. We're talking about bodies. Is that clear? We're talking about physical bodies. Sickness, old age, death, birth. Birth, sickness, old age, and death refer to bodies. We are bodies. Our minds are in our bodies. It shares this life with our body. And our body has its own life. And that life is conditioned by impermanence. It has its own nature. The mind would love to live forever. I mean, if everything was going its way. You know, when everything's going your way, you go, gee, I'd like to live forever. Right? Is that true? Yeah. I'd like the party to just continue forever. But the truth is what? It will not. I mean, many people can't even live long, as long as a parrot or a turtle. Turtles outlive us, right? Certain kind of turtles. That's humbling. But that's the truth, isn't it? So when we talk about the five remembrances, we are talking about the body. We have to remember that we are bodies, and bodies have their own laws. They start out, how do they start out? Little tiny things. Can't even see them. Little sperm, little egg, right? Very tiny, then it kind of grows, right? Becomes a fish and a reptile and salamander and all kinds of things on its growth, right? Eventually it comes out, you know, like this. Wah! I mean, you know, that's the nature of body, you know, that's it. Slowly it begins to form, and you know. And then it starts going the other way. Right? That is the nature of bodies. Flowers, leaves, branches, books. Look at this book. See? See this book? White. Look at this book. Aging. Look at this book aging compared to that book. Now again, there are the conditions, quality of paper, how it was taken care of, all kinds of conditions. Right? So 1999. What's that? 15 years? Aging. That is its nature. Books have their own nature. Impermanence. They deteriorate. Everything deteriorates. Since we're getting close to the end, we'll come to the big one. I am of the nature to die. There is no way to escape death. Gunther, you talk about things that people don't like to think about? Try this one. Everybody dies. Everybody we know will die. Many people we knew have died. Is that true? Yeah. People are exiting all the time. We even have a section of the paper. Right? It's called obituaries. We have pictures of them. A little, you know. Who exited today? Bum-ba-bum-ba-bum-ba-bum. Right? I mean, that's how normal it is. Right? Everybody dies. And that's not good or bad. That's not right or wrong. That is the nature of bodies. Is that true? Yeah. That's a big one. I mean, death is the biggest one for us. Many implications to the fact that we die and everyone dies. But that is the truth. I am of the nature to die. There is no way to escape death. The only thing that is unknown about death is what?
It's time.
It's time, yeah. Yeah. When's it going to come? And how's it going to come? We don't know, do we? We don't know. We think, you know, it comes in old age. Statistically, it does, but we know that's not true either, right? We know babies die and children die and young adults die. We know that people die of specific disease entities. We know people die by accident. Right? Road accidents or poisonings or people slip in the bathtub or all kinds of. This is a fragile universe. Right? This is a very fragile universe. This body is very fragile. Very easily does it end. Right? And you can just get in a car accident. You can just cross the street and be hit by a car and you're dead. I mean, that doesn't seem fair, does it? No, unfair. And yet it's true. Because these bodies are very fragile, right? Very complicated machines, you know what I mean? They're incredibly complex. You know, and, you know, as opposed to, like, trees. I mean, look at, I mean, you know, it would take a lot to take down that tree, wouldn't it? You know? I mean, I could probably run into it with a car, right? And I'd get hurt. The tree would probably still stand there. I mean, trees are impressive, right? I mean, we get blown away by a little bit of wind. I mean, we can be knocked over by a bicycle. Very fragile, this human body, this human condition. Is that clear? Now, am I delivering bad news? Gunther's our scientist. Gunther, is this bad news or is this just the truth?
Scientist, truth, human being, bad news.
Well, I was speaking to you as a scientist, okay? I wasn't speaking to you. Again, leaving aside for a moment, you know, our innate humanness. If we understand that this is the nature, we will no longer not accept death, the death, our death, the death of all our loved ones, the fact that death is in the world. It's the big one. We will no longer say, I can't believe it. How can we not believe it? It's normal. It happens all the time. It happens to everyone. Right? We just can't believe that it should happen to anybody we know. Right? I mean, you know, it's like we have a special world. Right? And like Gunther said, we have to come out of our ignorance, we have to come out of our emotionality, we have to come out of our fear, we have to come out of our irrational ideas that, you know, we'll live forever, or, you know, and accept the reality of it. Because Buddhism is a teaching that teaches us how to live happily with meaning and purpose in this life of impermanence. But it doesn't do that by creating an artificial world or by denying reality. I think that's the wonderful thing about it. It reconciles those two. It shows us, unvarnished, this is what's happening. This is real, right? And this is how you can live happily, intelligently, wisely within it. But it begins with this. First truth is what? Of the Four Noble Truths. There is suffering, which is a statement of looking deeply into reality. We'll get into that probably tomorrow. But is that clear? That's where it begins. And it ends with what? Enlightenment, nirvana, happiness. But it begins by taking an unvarnished look at reality. Yes, Brian.
You said that we don't need to leave our homes like the Buddha did.
Mm-hmm.
And leave our loved ones,
mm-hmm.
and then we can be fully engaged with life,
mm-hmm.
knowing impermanence.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, the more I reflect on the five remembrances, mm-hmm. and I reflect on what I want to do with my life, mm-hmm. you know, it starts to hit home more and more how short a time I have here, mm-hmm. and then I better get straight with what I want to do if I'm going to do it. It makes me kind of think, like, what's the point of going out, going to school, getting a career, all that? I mean, because it's all going to fall apart. It's not really part of my bigger aspiration. And mm-hmm. I'm, you know.
Yeah. No, I know what you mean. And that is obviously, you know, there are just different ways of dealing with it, dealing with this truth, right? You know, but even if one went off to say and joined a monastic community or something, I mean, that too would come to an end. That too is impermanent, and that life also is fraught with can be fraught with all kinds of ego problems, right? And delusion. So, you know, those are lifestyle choices. Mostly with right view, and we will get through over these next 4 days, it is teaching us that I can, depending on, you know, my life condition, whether I'm a layman or a laywoman, whether I choose a different route in life, or how I live my life, certainly has implications for a layperson. I think that is a... I mean, why do we need a career?
Pay bills.
So, I mean, unless we have a private source of income, we are left with having to pay bills. We're having to support ourselves, right? So that is one reason to work, right? Another reason to work could be what? Right, or to have money to help people, that could be another one. Like, you know, if I have the money, then I can be of help to people. What's another reason to have to find work?
To do something that you enjoy.
Yeah, or to do something meaningful. I mean, it's a way of you know, entering the world of, as a bodhisattvan saying, you know, I got to do something with my life. Well, this could be something. This type of work or this type of career is a means of actualizing my. My desire to be of service and help. So, I mean, work is just a word, but it can be, I mean, there are many meaningful reasons. You know, that's why it's called right livelihood as part of the Eightfold Path. So, I mean, you know, it's not all cut and dry, but it certainly may change your priorities, right? As opposed to seeing work as just a means of accumulating, you know, the purpose of life to accumulate things. More money, more wealth, more things, more experiences. One sees because of impermanence, because we know that if I'm working so hard to accumulate things, all of which are impermanent, then maybe I am putting my energy in the wrong place. Right? But it doesn't have to be, you know, dramatic. I'm just speaking up for your wife. I know she's not here, you know. Just I'd hate you to go home and tell her, Fred gave his teaching a retreat, so therefore, you know. I am of the nature to die. There is no way to escape death. Even if you're working out 3 hours a day, right? Even if you're having plastic surgery and all kinds of changing your body, even if you're taking supplements and doing everything else, just postponing the inevitable, isn't it? There's no way. Because this is the truth. It is the truth not of the Buddhas. It is the truth of reality. It's the truth of the body. The body, if we look at it, it will tell us its truth, right? and we can either accept it and live in harmony with the truth, or we can fight it and resist it, and therefore it will become a source of suffering. Right? Aging, sickness, and death become a source of deep suffering. There's a quote from the Buddha. To meditate persistently on impermanence is to make offerings to all the Buddhas. To meditate persistently on impermanence is to be rescued from suffering by all the Buddhas. To meditate persistently on impermanence is to be guided by all the Buddhas. To meditate persistently on impermanence is to be blessed by all the Buddhas. Interesting quote. Right? Many people think the way to be a good Buddhist is to make offerings to the Buddha, right? But the Buddha, according to this, says the Buddha said, to meditate persistently on impermanence is to make offerings to all the Buddhas. Again, as opposed to thinking of all the devotional things one can do to make offerings to the Buddha, meditating on impermanence is the best offering to the Buddha. To meditate persistently on impermanence is to be rescued from suffering by all the Buddhas, right? So many people who are traditional Buddhists may make offerings to the Buddha and then pray to the Buddha. Oh Buddha, free me from my suffering, right? People talk like that. People who pray to a deity talk that way, right? They ask the deity to free them from their suffering. First, they kind of give them a bribe. First, I'll bribe them, and then I'll ask them to do me a favor. Right? Sounds a little sacrilegious to call offerings bribes, but I think in a certain way, that's what we're up to, isn't it? And it's usually about me. It's not about everyone. You know, free me from my suffering. They say in various of the Buddhist Asian countries, some of the biggest days of people coming to the temples is like before entrance exams for college and high school. Right? Families are going there praying, Buddha, help my son or daughter get a good mark on their entrance exam so they can, right? First the bribe, then the request. But the Buddha said, to meditate persistently on impermanence is to be rescued by suffering by all the Buddhas. Do we want to be rescued from our suffering by the Buddhas? Then adopt their view and meditate on it persistently. To meditate persistently on impermanence is to be guided by all the Buddhas. We may pray, Buddha, guide me in my life so I always make right choices. Right? People pray like that, don't they, to a deity for guidance. Here, according to this text, the Buddha said, to meditate persistently on impermanence is to be guided by all the Buddhas. And then people also ask the deity for blessing. Bless me. Let your grace, let your blessings descend on me. And here he says, to meditate persistently on impermanence is to be blessed by all the Buddhas. You will receive the blessing of the Buddha. You will receive the guidance of the Buddha. You will be rescued from suffering by the Buddha if we simply meditate persistently on impermanence. I have tried this morning in talking about sickness, old age, and death, and in other ways, and we will continue furthermore. to demonstrate how one meditates on impermanence in reality. Is that clear? When you go outside and you see trees and you see plants and you see sun and sky, you meditate on impermanence. You look and you understand this is impermanent. Everything about this is impermanent. Right? It may be impermanent in an hour, in a day, in a year, but everything that I'm looking at is subject to change. Everything that I'm looking at is in a process of becoming or deterioration. Everything. Every person I see is in the process of becoming or deterioration. Everyone will die. You think about your loved ones. You think about your family. I mean, I could go on. There are many, many ways. You think about in the past that you loved, that became sources of suffering to you, right? Became enemies. Everybody know who I'm talking about? Right? True or not true? Right? Relationships. Oh, this is a source of great happiness to me. Right? 10 years later. Whoever talked me into this one? I mean, children, right? Children, right, come into this world, such wonder. And yet for many parents, their children become sources of suffering to them. Right? We have dear friends. We can't even remember their names now. We had, right? Friends become enemies. Enemies can become friends. We can befriend somebody, change our attitude, and everything changes. We can be successful, and then we can lose it all. Right? Remember Florida in the boom? Remember the boom? Everybody was flipping. I lived in Naples, Florida. I mean, I knew things were out of whack when my teenage sons or college-age son was talking to his friends in Naples, and they were flipping houses. I knew this is trying to get him to come on in on it. All of them got burnt. We gain, we lose. We're up, we're down. Success, we're liked and then we're disliked and then we're liked again. Right? They like us, they don't like us. We're successful, we're unsuccessful. Things work, things don't work. Right? Is that the truth? I mean, has anybody had a different life than that? What? No. I mean, that's life, isn't it? So therefore we have to say what? That's normal. Right? And yet we still live with this hope, right? Right, Gunter? That somehow it'll all be different. I can keep my stuff forever. And be happy. So it is important that we reflect deeply, persistently, as we've been instructed. And we will receive the blessings of the Buddha. We will receive the guidance of the Buddhas. Is that clear? So, we will begin in this retreat impermanence. Is there anybody not clear? So if you're outside, if you're walking about, other than fundamental mindfulness or presence, when you are using your mind, use it in this introspective, reflective way. When you eat your food, that food was once a living thing. It grew in the earth. Right? Somebody killed it for our benefit, right? That's true. And now, I mean, we don't eat it when it's dead, do we? Because we don't eat rotten food, do we? Right? We want to eat our food when it still has life in it. Right? but that life was taken for us. Is that true? Yeah. So we want to see this participation in impermanence is happening everywhere. This moment, impermanent. This body, impermanent. This community, impermanent. Everything changes. Right? People leave retreat and they say, see you at the next one. But we don't know if that's true, do we? No. Because everything's impermanent. Many variables, most of which we cannot see. So please, impermanence. Anything not clear? Good, so we will stop.